Affairs Council of Greater Reading is the leading educational organization promoting understanding and enlightenment on global issues. Welcome to today's presentation, and without further ado, I will turn the meeting over to the President of the World Affairs Council of Greater Reading for the introduction of our speaker, Dr. Solomon Walsh.
Well, thank you, Mike. Mike Sutton. We appreciate this. We appreciate all who are involved today in making this happen. We're very pleased to welcome John Walsh, Director, President, and Chief Executive Officer of UGI Corporation, a Fortune 500 company and a major player in the distribution of energy in the United States and across much of Europe. Two subsidiary companies locally here are UGI Energy Services, headquartered right here in West Reading, and UGI Utilities Incorporated, with a home base in Denver in Lancaster County. We're particularly indebted to Brad Hall, retired CEO of UGI Energy Services, for his role in inviting John to speak with us today on the topic, the future of energy. In addition to his long involvement and leadership in the energy industry, John is heavily committed to service within his community, including as director of Mainline Health Incorporated, the United Way of Greater Philadelphia in Southern New Jersey, the Greater Philadelphia Chamber of Commerce, the Sattel Institute, and the Philadelphia Zoo. Of special note to us is he is a director and past president of the World Affairs Council of Philadelphia. John, it is a pleasure to have you with us today, and we look forward to what you are sharing with us on this important topic of the future of energy.
Thank you, Dr. Lausch. It's a pleasure to be here, and thanks to the World Affairs Council of Reading for Greater Reading for having me, and a special thanks to Brad and Barbara Hall, who made this connection, and I'll talk a little bit about UGI's history and our future. And I have to say that Brad Hall played a key role in many of the growth elements and strategic elements for UGI. So I'm indebted to Brad and Barbara for making this connection and providing this opportunity for me to speak with this group today. I'll spend a few minutes on UGI's history. Some of you may know us. You may not know our history. We've been around about 140 years. We were founded in 1882 in Philadelphia, so we've always been a Pennsylvania-based company. And we were created to commercialize a new technology, an energy technology for coal gasification. So we have a history of commercializing new and emerging energy technologies. So that's very relevant today as we think about the current and the future direction of the company. Over its first few decades, UGI expanded and operationalized this new technology, becoming one of the largest companies on the New York Stock Exchange as we moved into the early 20th century. UGI operated and supplied technologies to utilities and energy companies across the U.S. and expanded very dramatically over the first 50 years of our existence, and had a footprint that, as I said, covered a large portion of the U.S. in terms of affiliate companies using this technology to produce and deliver and distribute energy. Early part of the 20th century, legislation was passed that mandated that you couldn't have utility holding companies. So the company went through a pretty dramatic period of divesting all utility holdings from the 30s, 40s, and into the 50s. So big changes then incorporated by government policy changes, Public Utility Holding Company Act, that reconstructed UGI essentially, and we came back to our Pennsylvania base. So by the 1950s we were a Pennsylvania base with our gas utility operations and our electric utility operations. Later in the 1950s, we entered what is now a very large business for us, the propane distribution business, as we initially purchased some small LPG distribution companies in eastern Pennsylvania, essentially extending the reach of our gas mains, going beyond our gas mains. That got us into that business, and today it's a significant business for us across the U.S. And in Europe. One other big technology change for us in the industry was that in the 1950s, that prior technology, which is termed manufactured gas, was replaced by natural gas. Interstate pipelines went into effect, and UGI and other every other utility across the U.S. eventually moved from that manufactured gas solution to natural gas. And obviously, that's had a big impact and enabled us to build out our infrastructure using those interstate pipelines as feeders for supply entered for us and others a period of significant growth in terms of utilization of natural gas to drive economic growth. I should comment on the importance of Pennsylvania, and I'll show you some statistics about UGI in a minute. As I noted, Pennsylvania has been UGI's home since our founding in 1882. The heart of our business still remains our utilities business. So that business that Saul mentioned, those businesses headquartered in and around Reading and now headquartered in Denver that serve Reading, Harrisburg, Lancaster, the Lehigh Valley, Wilkes-Barre, Scranton. That's really the heart and soul of UGI and remains so. About 800,000 of our 3 million customers are in Pennsylvania. About 3,000 of our 11,000 employees are in Pennsylvania. So Pennsylvania remains the core for UGI, even though the reach or the breadth of our business has expanded quite dramatically. We have a fundamental obligation and our role and mission as a company is to provide affordable, reliable, and sustainable energy solutions. And as we've grown over the years and as we entered the early 21st century, the use of natural gas and consumption of natural gas was such that the U.S. and UGI as part of the U.S. distribution system was really challenged with availability of natural gas. The cost of natural gas was rising. The U.S. was becoming a significant net importer of energy, and I'll talk to that in a minute. So that sort of set the stage for this century and some dramatic changes that have taken place in the 21st century. But before I go into that most recent period, I'd like to just give you a very high-level profile, and Tamika Morris of our IR team will share a slide. And we'll just give you a profile of the company. I won't go through all these numbers. Some of them I've touched on in terms of our employees and customer count. We do operate in every state in the US with our propane distribution business and in 17 countries in Europe. So quite a breadth. As I said, we've operated a long time, almost 140 years. We've paid dividend for 136 consecutive years, which is really important. And we've increased our dividends for the last 33 years. And strong economic performance, strong financial performance, very loyal shareholder base. And our fundamental mission, as I said, is to be a distributor and marketer of energy products and services, particularly around delivering affordable, reliable, and sustainable solutions. So I'd like to now spend a few minutes just talking about the most recent period. I talked about the start of the 21st century and some of the challenges there. Not too long after we get into the 2000s and the mid-2000s, we went through a period here that all of you are familiar with where shale resources in different parts of the U.S., but particularly in our region of the U.S. were not discovered, but made sort of economically and technically accessible by new technologies that are emerging. It's another example of UGI sort of being impacted by technology change and also positioning the company to make sure that we were taking advantage of and accessing the resources, in this case, that were made available by this technology change. So that development, which is only really about 15 years ago, totally changed the energy sector and the economics of the energy sector. The U.S. quickly went from a net importer of energy to now a significant net exporter of energy. We've seen the energy markets natural gas, and for our, in our case, we're a large LPG distributor, so the LPG market as well has become completely globalized. So you see U.S. exporting products such as LNG or LPG, liquefied natural gas, or propane, butane, to all parts of the world. So a huge change. That change has had a dramatic impact in multiple ways on our region. Natural gas became an abundant and low-cost resource, and it had a number of positive economic impacts on not just the business community, but basically on every resident of the Commonwealth. There's a slide I'll share with you that will show what's happened to energy costs over that period, and I think we've chosen the period 2009 to the present. It shows on the left shows a really the average monthly utility bill for a UGI customer in 2009. That's the left bar there, and in 2020. So you see about a 30% reduction in average monthly bill for the average UGI customer in 2020 versus 2009. If you look at that, if you look at the savings, and this is predominantly savings for families, our residential customers and small businesses, those savings total about $3.6 billion in the 2009 and 2020 period. And basically, as the cost of natural gas fell, those costs get passed through by us and other utilities. That's the way our rates are and tariffs are structured. So any savings we see in the cost of natural gas gets passed through to customers. So the vast majority of that $3.6 billion in the period 2009-2020 go to families, because the largest segment of our customer base is the residential segment. And the other very significant portion of our customer base is the small businesses we serve. And again, these are families and small business in Reading, Harrisburg, Allentown, Bethlehem, et cetera, and those cities we serve across the eastern half of the Commonwealth. Those savings are meaningful and very important to those families. And it's, again, part of our fundamental obligation we see to ensure that we're providing affordable energy to our customers. The figure on the right is a national figure in terms of savings by American businesses over that same period, that $120 billion. So again, a very significant number. Our figure that I'm referencing on the left there, the 3.6 billion, includes our residential customers as well as our small business customers. So the development of shale resources, hugely important, economically quite important in terms of affordability, but also important in terms of economic development and growth across large portions of the service territory that we serve in the eastern half of Pennsylvania, had a very positive effect in terms of economic development and growth, and also resulted in expansion of a number of significant companies we serve, some pharmaceutical companies, paper products companies, many companies in energy intensive sectors made decisions to not only stay in Pennsylvania, and some had been leaving in the decades prior to this when energy costs were rising. So they made the decision not only to stay in Pennsylvania, but to expand their facilities in Pennsylvania. So it created economic expansion and new jobs. So the development of the resource has been, from an economic standpoint, really important, important to our customers, important to the region in terms of economic growth. But also, at the same time, there's been rising concerns and discussions around environmental impact, climate impact of the development of this resource and fossil fuels more broadly. That's a critically important consideration that has to be factored in and is factored into the assessment of the future path of our sector, and certainly each individual participant in the sector and companies such as ours need to really focus on what we can do, and I'll comment on that, but what we can do to be part of a solution in terms of delivering energy solutions to customers that are affordable, but also from an environmental standpoint, progressive and effective in terms of limiting and eliminating emissions of multiple sorts, greenhouse gas emissions, carbon emissions, and other emissions as we source and deliver that energy. There's a significant focus on the part of regulators and policymakers on all of us that are part of this sector, and that's very appropriate. And all of us in the sector need to be committed to continuous improvement across our in many aspects. Environmental is absolutely one of the factors that's at the forefront. Safety is another, and we need to be transparent in terms of how we communicate and what we communicate with our customers, with our regulators, and with the policymakers who impact us. One example of that is an environmental, social, and governance report that we issue at UGI every year. That's on our website. So if you go to our website and look for our ESG report, you'll see in that report a pretty comprehensive summary of all the steps we're taking to improve and enhance our environmental performance and to ensure that we're positioned and we're to serve our customers with environmentally responsible solutions that are getting progressively cleaner as we move forward. So it's been an interesting period the last 10 to 15 years, huge advances in terms of resource availability and huge improvements in terms of affordability from a customer's perspective, and also a building dialogue and lots of action around sustainability and environmental impact and minimizing the environmental impact of our activities. So now we kind of shift and look to the future. Certainly sustainability must be a primary driver for energy policy along with affordability and reliability. The ways this has been described is an energy trilemma. That's not my term. I think it's a combination of dilemma and trifecta, I think, but it's an effective way of just stressing the importance of balancing all of these critical factors. Sustainability, crucially important, and I'll talk a lot more about that in a minute or two. I've commented on affordability. It's really, from my mind, one of our real fundamental obligations as an energy distribution company serving the 3 million plus customers we serve. The vast majority of our customers are families and small businesses who rely on us to ensure that they have affordable energy when they need it. So I think as we look at new solutions and incorporating new technologies as we have over our last 140 years, the environmental impact of those technologies is very, very important, but also affordability, kind of the burden. How do you balance that with the burden on customers for sort of affordable energy solution, and the burden the cost of energy might place on those families? You know, our customer base in Pennsylvania kind of reflects the communities we serve. So if we're able to save the average family, you know, $500, $700 a year in their energy costs by being efficient in terms of the solutions we can source and deliver, that's significant. That's meaningful for our customers. And we want to make sure that we're doing that. The other important element, in addition to sustainability and affordability, is energy security, or I would term it reliability. And that's just the importance of having energy available when you need it at the most critical times, during periods of extreme cold or extreme heat, We've seen examples, you can look to Europe and Germany in some recent years, and even domestically in California in certain periods, where sort of the lack of balance of energy supply and the lack of balance in terms of solutions that are available during extreme conditions resulted in some concerns and actually some disruptions in, from an energy security or reliability standpoint. So the that balance that is sort of captured in this slide is crucially important. We have already demonstrated, in terms of things we've done at UGI and the industry in general, that the commitment is there and progress is being made in terms of sustainability and environmental impact. A number of steps have been taken over the big ones in areas over the last decade. For example, significant conversion of coal-fired power generation across the U.S., but particularly in our region, has taken place. So moving from coal-fired power generation to natural gas-fired, major reductions in greenhouse gas emissions, major reductions in other effluents, and major progress. If we look forward, if you project forward over the next 30 years, there'll be a continued trend, certainly, for renewables becoming a more and more critical element of sort of power generation stack or the solution around power generation. Natural gas will as well. And natural gas and renewables together will drive growth in terms of the ability to provide reliable and affordable energy solutions, in this case, power to customers. You can see the progress that's been made over the last almost 30 years, where current emissions, in spite of economic growth and et cetera, you know, current emissions, CO2 emissions from energy consumption in the US are now at levels that are approaching levels in 1992. So you can see it peak in 2006, which also corresponds to when natural gas became abundant and affordable. And we started major conversions of coal fire generation to natural gas. So you see the positive impact it's having. There's no reason why that trend shouldn't continue as renewables play a bigger and bigger role in terms of that energy spectrum and natural gas utilization for energy consumption, and now increasingly in terms of transport, plays a crucial role. This progress definitely will continue and can and should accelerate. So I don't expect this curve to flatten or turn up. I expect that progress to continue, and it's frankly an obligation that we have at UGI to be part of the solution in terms of being innovative and approaching our customers with solutions that enable them to have an affordable energy solution that's reliable, that is also from an environmental standpoint progressing in terms of reducing and eliminating carbon emissions. So some of this turns to us. You know, I've talked about the sector overall, and the sector obviously is comprised of many, many entities and companies that are part of this very large sector. So at this point at UGI, we have to make sure we're doing everything we can to be part of the solution and in terms of delivering innovative solutions to customers. So over in the very recent period, we've made a number of investments. Those investments that are aimed at reducing our emission profile are not new to the company. We've been active really for the last 20 years, making a number of investments and have solar investments and landfill gas recovery investments that go back a number of years. But this work has accelerated in recent years. So recently, if you've been paying attention or seeing announcements from UGI, you've seen a number of investments that we've made. We We recently announced a series of new investments, and just I'll briefly touch on them. We acquired a company called GHI, that's a renewable natural gas distribution company. And you can see, renewable natural gas, pretty simple and straightforward process here. We recover CO2 and methane from landfills and from other sources, biodegradable sources, industrial waste, et cetera. We basically clean up those streams to create a renewable natural gas stream that's then delivered in our systems and our networks, or delivered to a customer who's using it for a transport application, and it's consumed as natural gas, having been produced by renewable resources. From a carbon standpoint, this is a really interesting and exciting development. It's not a new, but it's accelerating and being enhanced. In many cases, depending on the nature of the feedstock and source of the methane from those industrial or biodegradable sources in particular, not only do you have a zero carbon resource, you actually have a negative carbon resource in many cases because of the positive impact of the collection of that refuse, for example, from farms, and then utilizing that output for natural gas consumption. So it's exciting for us. It's driven a number of investments. The GHI investment is a renewable natural gas distribution company. They supply a number of fleet transport companies in California, where there's a very active market and demands to convert fleets to renewable resources. So that's a major step forward for us. We invested in a utility scale RNG infrastructure project in Idaho, again, using similar to this this schematic here, where we're investing with partners to a very large scale biodegradable sort of feedstock infrastructure sourcing project, clean that up, take that product, use the existing local and interstate delivery systems to move that product to customers. We also announced in Pennsylvania, closer to home, a natural gas interconnect agreement with a landfill gas developer in Northeast Pennsylvania. When that facility comes online, it'll become the largest renewable gas supply point in the United States. So we're very excited to be part of that. And we're also working directly with a number of customers as they look at their sort of carbon mandates. A great example of that is a project we're doing in central Pennsylvania with UPS. We're supplying UPS and enabling a large compressed natural gas fueling operation that UPS will conduct at that site. That compressed natural gas facility be one of the largest in the United States. That directly supports UPS as they strive to meet their own carbon targets, carbon reduction targets. Basically, UPS, some of their fleet, they're looking to convert to electric vehicles for their larger transports. Compressed natural gas is a great solution, significant carbon reduction when they convert. And in other portions of their fleet, we're also supporting them with LNG, liquefied natural gas, which can also be a very efficient solution for transport customers. So we're very active. We're excited about the opportunity to invest and grow in this in these emerging areas where technology plays a key role, and we think we will continue to play a key role in terms of our understanding of customer needs, our commitment to that balance of sustainability, affordability, and reliability, critically important. And we're excited to be able to bring those solutions to our customers in the most efficient way possible. So as we look forward, we will continue to look at every area we can to reduce our own emissions, We'll continue to focus hard on lowering the cost and ensuring that our solutions are affordable for our customers. And we'll always look for opportunities to be efficient. And that efficiency also enables and support affordability. We are today and will continue to work with research development companies and those that are developing, excuse me, new technologies. We want to be part of the solution and bring them. We want to bring them to our entire customer base because it's important that our customers benefit from these breakthroughs in new technologies. And we think we're best positioned to bring those solutions to our 3 million customers. We'll support customers with energy efficiency programs that enable them to use less energy. We're a business that invests with our customers to help them use less of our product. That's a fundamental driver and has been for a long time. Just a fact on our utility customer base, our average customer today, and we've served many of the same homes for decades, 50, you know, we have 40, 50 years of data on our customers. Our average customer today uses about 40 to 45% less natural gas than they did 40 years ago. So our customers have done a great job of being efficient with more efficient appliances, with adjustable thermostats, with now Nest devices. And we're happy when our customers use less because it makes our solution for them more affordable. And we'll continue to develop things like renewable natural gas and bio-LPG, which we've just invested in, and other emerging technologies. So we very much look forward to be an active part of the solution, focused on sustainability as a primary driver for us, and also on the critical obligation we have to our customers and our communities around affordability and reliability of energy solutions as well. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Saul, I think, for comments, and then at some point we're going to open it up for questions. So thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, John, very, very much. John, before we get into the Q&A part of things, and we do have several good questions coming in, I'd like to introduce Dave Bean, our Vice President of our World Affairs Council of Greater Reading here, and our Program Chair. And he'll share with us some of our upcoming programs, and then we'll return with you to the Q&A. David?
Thank you, Saul. Great program so far. Really looking forward to the Q&A. And as we transition there, as Saul said, I just want to let folks know what's in the pipeline, so to speak, with respect to upcoming programs in February, March, and April. All of these programs will be virtual and all are scheduled to start at 12 o'clock noon. Our second February presentation will be by Adam Wilczewski. His topic is trade issues confronting the Biden administration. He is scheduled to present to us on Wednesday, February the 24th. He is a former chief of staff of the International Trade Administration in Washington, D.C., and has served as an advisor on several past presidential campaigns, notably the Lieberman, Kerry, Biden, and Obama presidential campaigns over the course of the last 20 years. So that will be very informative. Two programs scheduled in March. The first is on the 17th by Nicholas Kraloff, who is the executive director of the Washington International Diplomatic Academy. And he's also a former correspondent for the Financial Times and the Washington Times. That's again, March 17th, the role of US diplomats. And our second presentation in March is on the 31st. Very excited about this one. Our presenter is our former ambassador to Zimbabwe, Charles Ray, and his topic will be, does Africa matter to the United States? And in April, two programs. Both of these programs are later in the month, the 21st and the 28th, so nothing the first 2 weeks in April. On the 21st, we're going to hear from William Pomerantz, who is a deputy director of the Kennan Institute. And his topic will be Russia. As we get closer to the presentation, that will be a more refined topic, but generally that's his area of expertise. So we'll be hearing more about that as we get closer, and we'll be certainly letting our members know what that topic will be. And then on the 28th of April, very excited, in conjunction with International Women's Day, a month late, but better late than never, our presenter will be Melissa Daring, who is an American attorney who teaches law at the University of Qatar. And her topic will be the importance of advancing women, peace, and security in Qatar. So some very exciting programs scheduled over the course of the next couple months. Stay tuned. And with that, I'll turn things back over to Saul and John.
Oh, great. Thank you. Thank you, David. I'm busily here also trying to capture some of the chats, that questions that are coming in, and hopefully I can do justice to it. From a person near and dear to your heart, Brad Hall, can UGI offer customers a green gas solution where we can get renewable natural gas, like the electrical utilities offer, offering 100% renewable options? And I may have scrolled that pretty quickly, but if that's sufficient, can you address that?
Sure, yeah, I mean, that's a great question. And yeah, something that we're very interested in pursuing. So I would encourage anybody who's interested in having a renewable natural gas option to let the PUC know about it. We certainly are having discussions with, and will continue a dialogue with, the Public Utility Commission and highlight the potential to offer a renewable natural gas solution to customers. It's certainly, as we become, you know, more active in renewable natural gas, it certainly becomes viable. And we have had more customers express an interest, residential customers and commercial customers. So we'd be really interested in that. That's a process we'd go through with the Public Utility Commission to agree on an approach similar to what's happened on the electric side. So yes, we'd love to be able to do that. We're doing our work, and we'll be in dialogue with the Public Utility Commission about that option for customers.
Great. Well, here's still another question here. The Biden administration, from Mike McCarthy, one of our board members, it stated its objective is to move away from fossil fuels. How might that evolve, and how long might it take before there is a market related to the Keystone XL pipeline project, for example?
You know, I think policy, it's a complex issue, and I think there are a lot of factors to it. I do believe that as we engage and talk through the issues, and also talk through the progress that's being made with regard to each of the elements of the solutions, you know, different renewable solutions, as well as improvements in the sort of traditional fossil fuel solution, natural gas, which is a low carbon fossil fuel. I think as you engage and get into the detail and people see the importance of sustainability, environmental impact, but also affordability and reliability as well, there's a balance that can be achieved. And actually is achieved over time, even in other places where you see some of that disconnect happening. I mentioned Germany earlier. You see policy evolving where all those factors, I think everybody can agree that those three factors I referenced are all important. And you have to, there's some balancing that's required to ensure that you're delivering on the commitment of secure, environmentally responsible and affordable energy. So I see dialogue happening. The way the energy sector is structured and regulated in the U.S., there's certainly elements where federal policy comes into play, but a lot of energy policy today, the vast majority, sits at the state level. So we're in addition to working with others at the federal level, we're in active discussion at the state level to, again, strike that balance to make sure we're doing the responsible things, something like renewable natural gas as a solution for customers, part of that dialogue. So I see the dialogue continuing, And I see a balance being struck over time. As I mentioned earlier, renewables will play a more and more critical role. In my opinion, natural gas, renewable natural gas, and our other products, LPG, which serves more rural and far suburban areas, and bio-LPG, which is a renewable product, and renewable dimethyl ether, which is a renewable substitute product for propane, all fit in if your goal is to, you know, significantly reduce carbon or hit a net zero mandate by a certain period, say by 2050. It's that those kinds of proactive, innovative solutions that are going to enable society to get to that kind of an outcome.
One of your the charts you showed us, I think if I'm remembering it correctly, 1982, the level of energy pollution, I guess I'm going to say it that way, was actually lower than it was maybe 20 years later. And now we're getting back closer to that.
So
maybe this question can address some of that. How much of the savings mentioned that we're achieving with the reductions in cost for the energy industry was the result of less consumption versus efficiency in the sector?
Yeah, it's a really good question, but it's the reverse. If you and I didn't want to have too many slides and kill everybody with slides. That's during a period where the economic output and the energy output rose pretty considerably over time. You know, and if you look at the picture for natural gas, that's absolutely the case. The emissions have fallen. If you just look at natural gas versus coal, you know, the overall output, energy output, is progressively higher each year. And those emissions are coming down during a period of growth. And the biggest factor, the two big factors in that progression in the 92 to present period with the reduction in emissions, energy consumption grew in total, natural gas conversion of coal-fired power generation, a big contributor to that, and the emergence of renewables, also a contributor to that.
A lot of questions coming in. We may not be able to address all of them, but I've been expecting this question, John.
Yep.
Should Pennsylvania have a severance tax on frack gas, as most other gas producing states do?
That's a question that's been asked many times. I'll just refer back to, there are taxes on natural gas and different taxes we pay. I think the key point for consumers to understand is that any tax on natural gas that's placed, while that tax may be paid by the producing company, that tax is then passed through to companies like us who source and distribute that gas, and it then finds its way onto customers' bills. So in reality, it's an indirect tax on our customers. So if there's an extra, whatever, you know, pick a percentage, if there's a 5% tax on natural gas, that's added to the cost of that product when it's produced to address, you know, sort of environmental impact and use those funds. The way that is collected in the end is through utility customers' bills. So what we have said in dialogue, as we've been asked about that, you know, we're not opposed to taxes and obviously we pay a lot of taxes, but we're not opposed to that. But it's just important to recognize that speaking on behalf of our customers, that tax will be paid by our customers. That severance tax is going to show up on the bills of, you know, our customers in Reading. They're going to pay that tax. So that, from a policy standpoint, that just has to be recognized.
So there's no such thing as a free lunch?
That's right. Okay. Yeah. And the good news is, Those families and small businesses have saved a lot of money, which is great, over the last 10 or 12 years. And the industry has to do its part to invest and ensure that we're minimizing the environmental impact of all of our activities. And that's, I can speak for us, that's happening. We're investing in our systems to ensure that we minimize emissions. And you know, we're probably... we've probably reduced our emissions by 60% since 1990, and eventually we'll get to that 95% reduction in emissions by 2030. You know, all those, and those are public commitments we've made in our ESG report. So we're not opposed to paying taxes, but we also think about the burden on customers.
Jen, you've really given us a good picture on how existing fossil fuels, particularly with natural gas, can be much more efficiently generated to get us to the point of zero footprint carbon emissions. What about some other alternative forms of energy production? Here in Berks County, for example, you have a small solar farm right here in Berks County. Yep. I'm assuming it's part of your effort to maybe research a little bit. I don't know. Yep. But let's take solar energy, and then we have another question also about hydrogen. What's your take on the whole issue of solar-powered energy alternatives?
Yeah, I mean, solar and wind are important, you know, an increasingly important part of the energy portfolio. I mean, one fundamental factor when we think about solar and wind specifically is that they're intermittent energy sources, meaning, you know, solar power is created when the sun shines. Wind energy is generated when you have wind, and the challenge is storing that energy. And that's why the reliability piece is so important. You know, if your energy balance is, well, if your energy portfolio is not in balance and you have concerns with availability of energy because the wind's not blowing or it's dark or cloudy out, that's a real issue. And that's some of the issues that California has seen, trying to balance their energy portfolio during times of any kind of stress on the systems or unusual times. A similar example, we're a renewable energy distributor in Europe. We have a company in the Netherlands that produces a lot of solar power and some wind power. It just so happens that from a weather meteorological standpoint, on the coldest days of the winter in the Netherlands, those tend to be still days, meaning not a lot of wind. And therefore, you have a peak energy need, meaning it's really cold and a lot of electricity is used for heating in addition to natural gas and propane. So you have imbalances. We see imbalances on those most critical days where we have insufficient wind and solar energy to support customer needs because the portfolio isn't appropriately balanced. So that's the importance of balance is I don't think can be overstated, because customers expect, and they rightfully expect, energy to be available. And if it gets really cold and really hot, our job is to make sure the energy is available no matter what. And that's why a balanced portfolio that has sort of different operating characteristics and attributes is really important. And it needs to be as clean as it can possibly be. But if you get imbalanced in terms of your sources of energy, you can very quickly compromise that reliability and availability obligation that you have as an energy company. So,
John, you have, we know you have a major footprint in Europe. I think you said 17 different countries where you're distributing energy. Mike, do you have any perspective on that? The Europeans and their use and consumption of energy, are there any cultural differences or economic differences as you see things between the United States and Europe?
I think it's been interesting the last 3, 4, 5 years, I would say. They've actually started to become more similar. The discussion around sustainability and environmental impact came earlier in Europe, or at least was at a level of priority in Europe in the communities we serve, going back a number of years. In the US, I would say that dialogue has really accelerated. It's always been part of the discussion, but it's accelerated over the last 5 years. I think in Europe, again, they've from a policy standpoint, they've been more proactive in some ways, but also I mentioned Germany, also they've demonstrated where moving too quickly or too dramatically in one direction can be destabilizing or disruptive from an energy security standpoint. So I think it's becoming more and more common ground actually between the US and Europe, and some of the larger differences around the relative importance of affordability versus sustainability and reliability. I think it's more common ground than it was certainly a decade ago or even 5 years ago between the two continents.
You may not have any take on either of these two points, but Mint noted earlier the use of conversion of creation of hydrogen as a fuel source. And I know here in the United States, there are some buses being run on hydrogen. I believe sure. That's true in India.
Yep.
What about hydrogen as a future source of energy?
Hydrogen certainly is interesting. And at different points in my career, actually with another company, I was involved with hydrogen and in the industrial gas business. Hydrogen is an interesting source. There are some challenges with hydrogen. It's extremely energy intensive to produce hydrogen. So to produce green hydrogen, you're using an electrolytic process to basically separate water into its components. That is very energy intensive. So you then need a renewable power source to drive the electrolytic process, which then creates very clean energy with hydrogen. The other challenge with hydrogen versus natural gas is just the energy content. The BTU content of hydrogen is such that it's not as efficient as natural gas. Having said that, there's a lot of, it's maybe similar to wind and solar 10, 15 years ago. There are a lot of advances being made in hydrogen. We have an interest. Hydrogen, for example, could be blended, be a blended part of our supply stream, and we could incorporate renewable green hydrogen into our supply stream and deliver it to customers. That's taking place on pilot level in some places in Europe. So that's a technology or an area that's of interest to us. We think renewable natural gas is more accessible and more viable and affordable in the short to midterm, but will likely be active, I would say, in green hydrogen and looking at how that might be incorporated into our supply portfolio.
Any thoughts on the, even thinking further out that not under the current thought, thinking nuclear fusion as a possible, how close are we to that or will it ever happen? And that, since I'm not, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I was gonna say that I have to pass on. I don't know, the hydrogen we're exploring, nuclear itself is a sort of an interesting area. It's obviously today still an important part of that portfolio of energy supply and some major issues and concerns around that. But I think it's an area that should be pursued again as part of this balanced approach to energy development and energy delivery. I don't have any insights on nuclear as other than to recognize that it's today still a very important part of that on the power side, that supply portfolio.
What about the use of ocean energy, ocean power?
One of the most efficient and attractive and longstanding sources of renewable energy is hydro, hydroelectric power, et cetera. So it's just another sort of approach to that. And I know there are technologies that are being, in terms of the wave created energy that are being pursued and developed. So, that's all very good stuff. I think the other consideration with these technologies is the actual delivery mechanism in terms of how you get the energy that's produced to the consumer. And that's, and we're a distribution company. We're physically connected to 3 million customers with a meter and either a gas line or a propane tank with a delivery line. So we think a lot about sort of the last mile or the last 50 feet of the journey of the energy to the customer's home or business. And that's a key part of, I think, the puzzle of the equation when you think about the new technologies is they've got to, in the end, get to the point of consumption. What's the how are you going to use your infrastructure? How does the available infrastructure support that? Or do you need to create fundamentally new delivery infrastructure to get it to, you know, we think of our 3 million customers, but to get it to the hundreds of millions of customers that are looking for these solutions. So that's an important consideration as well in terms of the source of the energy, but then how do you actually get that energy and how efficient is it to move that energy? How much energy are you losing as you move that renewable resource from the point of generation to the point of consumption? So, and I think that plays a role in certain technologies like hydroelectric power, et cetera, and other solutions. You've got to get it to the consumer in an efficient, safe manner with hopefully minimal disruption in terms of new infrastructure, and from the customer standpoint, try to mitigate or minimize what you ask the customers to do in terms of investment in new equipment in their homes, for example. So that's important for us as well. That's why renewable natural gas and bio, which is renewable bio LPG, that's why we really like those solutions, because we can use our existing infrastructure to source and move it. And from a customer standpoint, we're not asking them to change anything, meaning they can use their existing appliances to consume the renewable product, and they don't have to make an incremental investment to utilize that renewable product, which for us is attractive.
This may almost sound like a silly question, but you mentioned earlier in terms of renewables, taking gas from landfills and we're discussing that, and from the farming industry.
Yep.
The biggest single polluters, as I understand it, in the whole planet are farm animals, beef cattle.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
This is not meant to be a far out question, but is there any way in which you foresee capturing some of that methane?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. These, when I mentioned biodegradable sources, that is absolutely one of them. And the product that I referenced in Idaho, that's a dairy digester product. So that's doing exactly that. The exciting thing about where we sit in Pennsylvania is there are a lot of active farms in our region. So we have the opportunity to work with on our own or work with others to make investments in renewable infrastructure. And that captures that waste. We also just invested in a project in Poland where we're capturing industrial waste, our partner is, and producing bioethanol, which is then converted into multiple products, including bio-LPG. So we're taking a non-usable industrial waste and turning it into renewable energy solutions, in our case, bio-LPG. So the more we can do of that, the better. And those are the instances where you're truly having a huge impact in terms of carbon emissions. That's where there's a potential to have a negative carbon energy solution for a customer by virtue of kind of what you're eliminating in terms of that waste and the impact that the waste is having on the environment if it isn't captured utilized.
We had a question earlier illustrating India and China with the big, all the pollution that is happening there. As we know, with this COVID breakdown in India, for example, we saw how much pollution in the cities actually diminished because vehicles weren't being used so much. Yep. We know the Chinese are investing a lot in the electric car future. we can trust the Chinese to always be at the forefront. To what degree do you see the Chinese as major competitors with us here in the United States?
I think, for sure they are competitors in many ways. They're going to drive technology and investment as well. If you look at some of the solutions that are emerging, the U.S. is still the source of a lot of technology and a lot of solutions. So I see that as being a motivation for all of us to, you know, in terms of being competitive and delivering solutions. It's clear that in China and India, as they've grown so dramatically, they're now focused on steps they need to take to reduce their emissions. Transportation is certainly a huge sector, in addition to farming, in terms of emissions. And we're excited about, electric vehicles will certainly play a major role, and you see a lot of announcements on that. But renewable natural gas also potentially will play a significant role. We see it already in a state like California, where I mentioned the investment we made earlier this year, where fleets are converted, or there's mandated carbon reduction for fleet operators. So renewable natural gas is a great solution for them. And that could be an approach that comes to other states. For example, in addition to California, that's got a very active and, longstanding program for renewable transport fuels, other states are very interested in incorporating that to drive conversion from diesel, say for heavy duty trucks and fleets, to renewable solutions. And for very large vehicles, electric vehicles are a challenge for that kind of payload, whereas renewable natural gas is a great solution, a zero carbon solution. Something like LNG, which we also produce and distribute, is a really effective solution in dramatically reducing carbon and other effluents from heavy duty transport vehicles. So we're excited about, in addition to serving our core customer base, residential and small business, to expand our service into the transport segment as well with renewable solutions.
Well, we've had a lot of questions coming in today, and I'm sorry we can't get to all of them, but here might be a really good wrap-up sort of question for today, John. Peter Terranova asked us, we hear a lot about initiatives to phase out the use of fossil fuels without distinguishing between them. You've addressed some of this. But what are your views on the impact these initiatives will have on energy consumers? It's a good way for you to give any kind of final wrap-up comment you'd like to make.
Sure, yeah, thanks, Peter, for that question. Yeah, I do think it's really important to be clear in terms of solutions and the positive impact of lower carbon solutions. Like natural gas is a great example. And over the last, say 40 years, as an example, UGI has converted over that time, probably 300,000 customers from fuel oil to natural gas. In doing that, you do two things for customers. Typically, you're saving the customers money, so you got an affordability solution, but you're also dramatically reducing carbon emissions by virtue of a much lower carbon solution. So, and that chart I showed that showed the progress over time, that's natural gas displacing coal for power generation. I think those are important elements and steps towards reaching carbon goals. Whatever carbon goals have been set by individual companies or by states, or if the federal government sets standards, it's important to take those incremental steps, because the technology around delivery of conventional solutions like natural gas or LPG those solutions are going to progress as well. And some of the things we're actually doing and incorporating renewable solutions into that existing supply portfolio will enable us to continuously reduce carbon. So it's important to differentiate within fossil fuels and identify the progress that's been made through utilization of more efficient, lower carbon solutions, because those are enabling major steps forward to a low carbon or zero carbon economy.
Well, thank you very much, John. Brad Hall, as I noted earlier, who introduced us to you, said he's a really nice guy, and it's good to see that nice guys do finish first in this in the economy, no matter what the sector. We really appreciate your sharing with us today and your insights. We don't often have CEOs of a Fortune 500 company with us, and we're glad that you could do that for us. Thanks very much for taking the time with us, John. We really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Dr. Walsh, and it's my pleasure to have spent the time with this organization. Happy to do it.